Our next speaker will be Kathleen Peratis, who's a board member of J Street, the Forward Human Rights Watch, the former vice president of the New Israel Fund, the former president of the NYCLU, an occasional columnist for the Forward, and somehow has the time to actually have a job. She's a partner at the New York law firm of Outman Golden LLP. Thanks so much.
I'd actually like to stand up if you don't mind. I first want to say that I agree that this conversation should be and has so far been and hope will continue to be respectful and civil. I have a great deal of regard for my co-panelists, and I think I have a lot of sympathy and understanding for the motivations that bring them to the BDS movement, although I think it's a mistake. I'm going to try to not use the kinds of tired slogans that you're used to hearing from anti-BDS people, the kinds of tired slogans that don't get us anywhere, the kinds of slogans that Netanyahu used at the GA last week. I just don't think that most of them matter much. I think demonizing each other doesn't make much sense. I want to kind of an epigraph for my presentation to you comes from a poster that I saw was actually in a story in the Forward last week about the John Stewart rally a week or so ago on the Washington Mall. Somebody was carrying a poster that said, "I don't agree with you, but I'm pretty sure you're not Hitler." And I think that is so much what both extremes of this conversation accuse each other of, and I'm not going to do that. I want to give you the four reasons that I think the global BDS movement is a mistake, but I first want to tell you what I think we agree upon. I think what we agree upon, what I would assert, is that the occupation is a violation of international law, that it's an assault on the dignity of the Palestinian people and their right to self-determination, that it's a scourge and an embarrassment on the state of, on the principles of on which the state of Israel was founded, and it's also an embarrassment and a violation of my personal values as a Jew and as a human rights activist. But here are some of the markers that I think we might not agree upon. I believe that the only peace worth having is a peace in which there are two states, one of them a Jewish democratic Israel, one of them Palestine. I have not given up on a Jewish democratic state of Israel. It is a challenge, but I haven't given up. And if I had, I wouldn't be here speaking as I am. Some of you have given up, but I want you to know that I haven't. The second marker is that the border should be approximately on the green line with some land swaps, that Jerusalem should be shared between both peoples. It should be a capital of Israel and a capital of Palestine, divided in a manner that is not rocket science, and that the Palestinians should exercise their right of return within Palestine. There should be some family reunification, there should be compensation, but the Palestinian right of return should be exercised within Palestine. I believe anyone who does not support sharing Jerusalem is an obstacle to peace. I think anyone who doesn't support the right of return being exercised within Palestine is an obstacle to peace. And I think that is probably something that my co-panelists and I, some of them disagree with. When I say a full right of return of 6 million refugees, when the BDS movement advocates a full right of return of Palestinian refugees within the Green Line, I think that constitutes an obstacle to peace, and that's why mainstream American Jews and Israelis are so in opposition to this movement. It's no secret that the PA will settle for a right of return within Palestine. It's no secret. Everybody knows that if there's going to be a deal, that's going to be part of the deal. To the extent that the BDS movement closes its eyes to that reality, I think the global BDS movement is an obstacle to peace. Now let me give you the four reasons that I think this movement is counterproductive and diversionary and a mistake. The first reason is, to the extent that the goal of the movement is to inflict economic pain on Israel, it will fail. Israel's economy is booming. The high-tech sector is thriving. Tel Aviv was recently named one of the most livable cities in the world. The economic impact of this movement is zero. Naomi Klein is quoted as saying, "Boycott is not a dogma, it's a tactic. In a country so small and trade-dependent, it could actually work." To this I say no. Because Israel is so economically strong and interconnected with the global economy, this movement cannot work. I don't think anyone actually disputes this, although I may be proved wrong tonight. The movement has racked up what it calls successes. There's a long list of successes in Adam's piece in The Nation several weeks ago. What I would like to say to you is that that list could be twice as long. It could be 10 times as long, and it will make no difference. Whatever the global BDS movement people don't buy, every investment it doesn't make is a blip. Everything they don't buy will be bought 10 times over by others. Thousands of other people will fill that void and will have a great time doing it. If BDS people don't invest, billions of other dollars will be invested in their stead. Even very progressive Jewish activists who support anti-occupation, who support peace, will not support this movement. And in fact, what's going on in Brooklyn with this Ahava boycott, which many of you know about, has caused many people, probably most of them Jews, to buy more Ahava products. I will be very interested to know what happens to the Rickies here in Brooklyn, to see whether or not they end up with more money or less money next month. I'll bet they're going to be doing better because of the boycott. Omar Barghouti, who is a Palestinian activist, famously said, "If you can boycott an egg, boycott an egg." I think that's a very nice line, but strategically, it means to me that this is not an economic boycott. It's about atmospherics, it's about branding, it's about demonizing. The only success of this movement is to demonize Israel, and that will make people feel good, but at best, it will make no difference. Which brings me to my next point. To the extent that the goal of this movement is to further scare and marginalize Israel into changing course, it will fail, and it might even make things worse. There was another sign at the John Stewart rally that said, "If I scare you, you'll do what I say." Now, we all know that that just doesn't work, but that's what this movement is, one of the things it's based on. Jews in Israel have a long history of being vilified and demonized and delegitimized. I want to tell you I hate that word, but I'm using it in this context. When the global BDS movement does that, Jews and Israelis believe it is just more of the same historical Jew hatred that's been present for centuries, and that's how they read this movement. In fact, this movement does mobilize anti-Israel hatred and anti-Semitism and unites those of you who are honest critics with those whose goal really is to end the Jewish state. There are some people who actually want to end the Jewish state. You may be shocked to hear. In the face of organized criticism and demonization, Jews circle the wagons. It's not paranoia, it's history. You know the story of the old Jew who spent his first 40 years in Eastern Europe seeing signs that say Jews go to Palestine, and the next 40 years in Israel seeing signs that say Jews get out of Palestine. This is how this movement feels to a lot of Jews, both here and Israel. The demonization has done no good. It's made Israelis feel more isolated, more victimized, and more alone. Is there anybody who thinks that all of a sudden victimizing and isolating is going to suddenly work? I don't think so. Okay. My third point is that only the government of the United States and American Jews can actually influence Israeli conduct. Only to them might Israel actually listen. You've heard from Adam about this ferocious reaction in the Jewish community. I'll skip this point. But my fourth point is, and the one that I think moves me the most, this movement amounts to giving up. And and walking away from Israel, while I think only engagement has any chance of success. The orgy of violence that began in 2000 caused the collapse of the Israeli left. For 5 years, the Israeli left was simply marginalized and made to think that they had totally wasted their time. I started going to Israel 20 years ago, and I've gone several times a year, most years since then. There is so much hope, so much burgeoning of left activity in Israel. I want us, all of us, who believe in peace, who believe in ending the occupation, to be with them. Pressure from American Jews who endorse a Jewish state, who are engaged with Israel, who love Israel, and I mean love Israel. These are the voices that have a chance in Israel and in Congress. The BDS movement does the opposite. My real beef with BDS is that this movement has taken you away from Israel, and it's taken you away from the Israelis who want to partner with you. It means if you walk away, it's like I watch cooking programs a lot. You know, at the end of the contest, put it down, walk away. I don't want to put it down and walk away. I want to be there for NIF. I want to be there for Peace Now. I want to be there for all the left organizations who are trying to rebuild this peace movement. I don't want to put it down and walk away. I don't want you to put it down and walk away.